11th of April, 1755, Mary Parkinson, wife of apothecary surgeon John Parkinson, gave birth to their first son, James. James was christened on 29th of April in St. Leonard's Church in Shoreditch. John and Mary went on to have 6 children, of which 3 died in infancy, a common enough picture in these pre-sanitation days. The family lived at No. 1 Hoxton Square, an elegant end-of-terrace townhouse on 3 levels built around 1700, with access to the public square. At that time, in the mid-18th century, Hoxton represented the end of the City of London, with fields and country houses beyond. Over the intervening years, Hoxton and Hoxton Square have changed much. Parkinson's own house became derelict by the early 20th century and was subsequently demolished and replaced by a more modern building. Nonetheless, the current building bears a blue plaque in honour of James Parkinson. John Parkinson was an apothecary, similar in its day to what we would now call a pharmacist or a chemist. Apothecaries would make up medicines for doctors, surgeons and patients, essentially a part of what the modern-day pharmacist would do. And it was not just medicines. Despite being in the middle part of the 18th century, leeches were still popular for cleaning wounds and general bloodletting. John Parkinson also worked as a surgeon. Surgery in the 1750s was very different from the 21st century. Principally, it consisted of lancing boils, draining abscesses, and even amputating limbs. In these pre-anaesthetic days, surgeons were prized on their ability to work quickly, although typically a leg amputation would take perhaps 3 minutes. Some were faster. The record was held by one Joseph Liston, who removed a leg in 28 seconds, and routinely invited observers to time him. Speed, of course, is not always consistent with accuracy. In one of his operations, not only did he remove the patient's leg, but also his testicles. In another, he also amputated 3 fingers of a surgical assistant, this mishap resulting in the death of both assistant and patient from post-operative infections, as well as one observer who had a heart attack, a 300% mortality. Surgery in the 18th century was haphazard at best. It was taken as read that James would follow his father into practice as an apothecary surgeon. In 1771, he started an apprenticeship with his father, and with this in mind was sent in February 1776 to the newly built London Hospital, now the Royal London Hospital, a short walk away in Whitechapel, for 6 months' practical medical experience. The London Hospital Medical College, Britain's oldest medical school, had opened in 1754, moving to purpose-built facilities in 1795. It's a common misconception that James Parkinson was a doctor. Although he enrolled at the London Hospital, he did not formally train as a physician. His training, like his father's, was as an apothecary surgeon. But if you dig a little further, you soon discover that that was a small component of James Parkinson the man. There's plenty more to discover. James Parkinson, although first and foremost a man of medicine in a bustling and underprivileged part of London, somehow found time for several other activities, including marrying his childhood sweetheart, Mary Dale, in 1781, at St. Leonard's Church again in Shoreditch. Mary and James had 8 children, 6 of which survived into adulthood. Beyond medicine itself, which ran as a thread throughout his entire life, his adulthood can, broadly speaking, be divided into 2 distinct parts, political and paleontological. James Parkinson could have lived an easy life as a medical practitioner, his income adequate for his needs and those of his family. Indeed, he had been born, if not into a life of luxury, certainly one of plentiful sufficiency. But somewhere along the line, somewhere along the journey, he became what we might call today radicalised, increasingly finding himself sympathising with a largely overtaxed and downtrodden working class. In 1792, Parkinson joined the London Corresponding Society, a recently founded group of political agitators pushing for universal suffrage and constitutional reforms. Now, bear in mind that the French Revolution had only recently taken place, and thus a whiff of rebellion was very much in the air. In 1793, the King of France, Louis XVI, was executed. Meanwhile, in Britain, there was anxiety that similar thinking might develop. Parkinson began to show his true colours with the publication of several pamphlets criticising the government in increasingly strident tones. The pamphlets were probably the Twitter of their day, short polemics intended for a wide readership and intended also to evoke a reaction, essentially fomenting civil disobedience. Not surprisingly, he published these under a pseudonym, Old Hubert. As far as I know, there's no record of why he chose that particular name. The London Correspondence Society continued to be active, and Parkinson continued to grumble away, snapping at the heels of the government. The government's response was to brief the magistrates to find the writers and publishers of these pamphlets. The magistrates in turn set up a network of spies and informers, infiltrating the London Correspondence Society and other groups, monitoring their activities. We should remember that towards the end of the 18th century, punishments, tending to be draconian anyway, included imprisonment or deportation. These were not uncommon. Against this repressionist backdrop, lesser men might have withdrawn or retracted. Parkinson, on the other hand, chose this moment to publish his most extreme pamphlet yet, entitled Revolution Without Bloodshed, in 1794. By any standards, this was asking for trouble. Whether a direct consequence or not is hard to tell, but immediately after its publication, four members of the London Correspondence Society were arrested on trumped-up charges. These included an alleged plot to assassinate King George III. The plan, if you can believe it, involved a poisoned dart being shot from a pop gun at the king, the kind of thing a young schoolboy might imagine. Even at this point, Parkinson threw caution to the winds and informed the Privy Council that he was prepared to vouch for the innocence of the alleged conspirators. Parkinson was inevitably summoned and faced a barrage of questions, some from the Prime Minister of the day, William Pitt the Younger. Eventually he was released and any charges dropped. Parkinson was, after all, a well-known public figure, so the Privy Council had to tread carefully. The other accused were also released after several months in jail. It was, however, the end of the road for old Hubert. Parkinson ceased political agitation at this point, and although still espousing such ideas, kept them to himself and reserved his pamphlets for less contentious subjects, such as medicine, after all what he knew best. He even wrote one on how to correctly wear a surgical truss, a world apart from his earlier political commentaries. But even here, Parkinson found subjects for his writing, from the chemical pocketbook to observations on the nature and cure of gout, the villager's friend and physician, through to the magnificently entitled Hints for the Improvement of Trusses. Parkinson had something to say about most things. He even took it upon himself to publish about dangerous sports in 1807, a fairy tale or parable intended for children and describing the worry they caused their parents through such participation. From his mid-40s onwards, Parkinson found himself increasingly interested in fossils and the information they bore about the development of the planet and how they might be interpreted in the context of religious belief. And Parkinson, being Parkinson, threw himself wholeheartedly into investigating the fossil record and what it said. Now, you might think geology and paleontology to be rather dry subjects, perhaps suited to a single man with a rock hammer. But not with James Parkinson. His geological investigations became family excursions. His children helped him collect fossils. His daughter Emma even coloured in some of the illustrations in his books to such a standard that they were later reproduced in Gideon Mantell's own books. Of course, the mark of a good paleontologist is to be able to convey the knowledge you've accrued by writing a book on the subject. Parkinson wrote four books, parts 1 to 3 of Organic Remains of a Former World, as well as a single volume Outlines of Orectology, intended as an introduction to the study of fossils. Significant achievements, but for a real paleontologist, their badge of honour, if you will, is to have a species named after them. Parkinson had several, both animal and vegetable, including a snail, an ammonite, and a turtle. And as if that wasn't enough, by way of achievement, we shouldn't forget that he was also one of the founders of the Geological Society of London. When James Parkinson chose to do something, he did it wholeheartedly. He was not a man of half measures. Interesting and time-consuming as his other activities were, significant acts of scholarship for the most part, it is for a small booklet on a matter of, at the time, marginal interest that he's best remembered. A booklet describing a condition so uncommon that he could only find 6 patients to describe. And of those, only 3 were subjected to anything like a genuine clinical examination. A further 2 were observed and questioned in the street, while the 6th was only observed at a distance. In this particular case, Parkinson never even spoke to the individual. A book of minority interest at best, not as a description of a major killer such as typhoid or cholera. The essay on the shaking palsy was published in 1817. These were turbulent times in Britain and Europe. Wellington had defeated Napoleon at Waterloo in 1815, albeit at a high cost to the British economy and some rioting. Jane Austen's Emma was published. The Elgin Marbles were on display at the British Museum. And in July 1817, the first sovereign coins were minted. In the face of such newsworthy items, there is little to be found on the impact of the essay at the time. That in itself speaks volumes. It's a testament to the skills of James Parkinson that such a book was publishable, even in the early 1800s. Parkinson himself probably didn't intend it as a scholarly work. To do that would necessitate peer review and publication in a scientific journal. And it's questionable whether his evidence base would have survived such a close scrutiny. What made this book so special? Firstly, the book shows the value of observation. Without observation, science is nothing. And observation must be impartial, unaffected by prior prejudices. Secondly, the book is about deduction, about making connections between observations. Initially considered to be 2 separate illnesses with different characteristics, Parkinson was the first person to recognise commonality and to propose a single unitary description. 1 condition, not 2. Thirdly, the book is about extrapolation. Parkinson projects into the future, to a time when the word cure can be envisaged. The book takes the entire natural history of the condition. And let us not forget that there were no treatments in 1817. It takes it from first symptoms through its entire progression. To achieve this on the basis of the handful of patients is the work of a scientist of extraordinary observational and deductive skills. Yet Parkinson wore his scholarship lightly. In terms of public writings, it was his first and only neurology report. Yet such is a measure of its importance that Parkinson is often spoken of as a neurologist manqué. It would be another 50 years before his primacy of thought was acknowledged, and Jean-Martin Charcot, perhaps the greatest neurologist of his day, gave the condition the name by which we know it now, la maladie de Parkinson, or Parkinson's disease. One cannot help but feel that if he was asked, Parkinson would not have considered this short essay as a major work. Odds are that he would have thought his paleontology and geology work to be most enduring. Time has proven him wrong. Between 1820 and 1824, James swapped houses with his son John, presumably for family reasons, and moved to number 3 Pleasant Close. But evidently there was still close contact, the houses being only a few streets away from each other. James Parkinson suffered a stroke on Sunday the 19th of December 1824, which paralysed him down one side and proved fatal shortly thereafter. His son, John, wrote to the parish with the news. Gentlemen, with feelings of deep regret, I have to announce to you that the death of a much beloved father. He was suddenly attacked on Sunday afternoon with a severe paralytic affection, which deprived him of his speech and of the use of his right side. Every means were employed for his recovery, but they proved to no avail, and he expired on Tuesday morning at 10:30. I have the honour to be, gentlemen, your most obedient servant, J.W.K. Parkinson. James died on Tuesday the 21st of December and was buried at St. Leonard's Church in Shoreditch 8 days later. The 29th of December was a busy day for St. Leonard's Church, with a further 5 parishioners being interred that day. But who was James Parkinson? What did he look like? For someone who has made such an impact on the field of neurology over the past 200 years, James Parkinson remains unidentified. Other celebrated neurologists, such as Jean-Martin Charcot or Gilles de la Tourette, have been widely depicted. Perhaps Google can help. Well, yes and no. A simple image search for James Parkinson comes up with this. A middle-aged man with moustache and beard and a slightly brusque demeanour. The kind of person you might imagine to be a surgeon. The image appears on the websites of many important scientific and medical societies. Despite our uncertainties on other aspects of his identification, we can at least be certain on this. This image is not James Parkinson. Or, more accurately, it's not the James Parkinson that we're looking for. Let me explain. This photograph is of Laycock Abbey, the view from one of the drawing rooms. The image is thought to be the earliest photograph taken in Britain, and it's dated 1837, 13 years after the death of James Parkinson. Indeed, the earliest photograph taken anywhere in the world is a view, albeit barely discernible anymore, of the countryside near Saint-Loupiac-de-Varennes. It was taken in 1827, still a minimum 3 years after his death. So it looks as though we've drawn a blank. Well, not necessarily. But we do have to resort to more extreme methods. Modern forensic science, for instance, is able to reveal information from beyond the grave. With a skull and some basic information about the ethnicity of the individual, an image can be developed. Such information is considered accurate enough to be used in a court of law. In the past, this kind of modelling would have been done by the use of modelling clay or plasticine, but nowadays needs no more than an MRI scan and the latest software. But even then, of course, it's dependent on exhumation. Exhumation orders are rarely given for such frivolous reasons. In actual fact, James Parkinson has been exhumed once at least, when the part of the cemetery in which he was buried was cleared to make way for road widening and more buildings. Many of the coffins were moved to the nave of the church or crypt and reinterred there. We cannot be with absolute certainty say that Parkinson was one of them. In any case, although diverting, it would seem unjustifiable to excavate the church and crypt to disinter Parkinson once more and to put him in an MRI scanner. However, the search for the face of James Parkinson is not over quite yet. Parkinson, as we discussed before, was very fond of pamphlets and published several of these during his lifetime, some political, some medical. One of these, from 1804, entitled The Villager's Friend and Physician, commonly referred to as the Alehouse Sermon, is a tract on general health and the promotion of domestic happiness. Quite a broad brief by any standard. Parkinson's recommendation was that the contents of the pamphlet be delivered by a village apothecary, a surprisingly prescriptive stipulation by any standard again. But most unusually, the frontispiece to the pamphlet contained a cartoon of just such an apothecary delivering the sermon. Since the pamphlet contained his thoughts and he envisaged it being delivered by someone of the same profession as himself, it's hard to conclude that the apothecary pictured is anybody other than James Parkinson. Descriptions of Parkinson are few and far between. One such description by Gideon Mantell, a friend and paleontological colleague, described him as rather below middle stature, with an energetic intellect and pleasing expression of countenance, and of mild and courteous manner. But before we accept this cartoon as the most authoritative image of Parkinson, perhaps even the only image of any credibility, there is one last avenue to investigate. A part of the social fabric of London during the 18th and 19th centuries were the many guilds of professional men. The guilds that represented the interests of their members, whether they be butchers, bakers, candlestick makers and so on. The guilds provided a source of fellowship for their members, but also had a charitable purpose as well. Much as today, in fact. One of the most interesting guilds or clubs founded in the early part of the 18th century was the Club of Odd Fellows. Essentially a guild for those who felt they did not fit in particularly well with any of the existing professional organisations. It provided similar facilities and had similar charitable aspirations, but its members came from a range of different professions. The club held regular meetings and dinners. These appear to have been fairly thirsty affairs. One such description at the time talked of meetings in much revelry and often as not needing the call of the watch. One such meeting on the 2nd of October 1789 was captured in an engraving by John Barlow. The scene depicted is very much one of revelry, but the image also contains a secret. The Guild of Odd Fellows offered a fringe benefit of medical help to its members. To this purpose, they employed a surgeon for the benefit of members and their dependents. Naturally, that surgeon would attend any of the functions laid on by the guild, and if you look closely at this picture, at the back can be seen a man holding aloft a medicine bottle and a script, signifiers of the man's status as surgeon. James Parkinson had been awarded the Grand Diploma of the Company of Barber Surgeons in 1784. The records of the Odd Fellows reveal that their surgeon at that time was James Parkinson. Comparison of the two images is interesting. Are they both the same man, about 15 years apart? Both have a round face, pointed nose and sharp chin. The man on the left was 34, while the 1804 man on the right looks older. He would have been 49. Neither image is definitive on its own. Two different personalities are portrayed, the one jovial, exuberant and full of youth, and the other more sober and restrained. In the end, perhaps we should not be surprised by the absence of images of James Parkinson. He did not seek celebrity in any understanding of the word. When awarded the gold medal of the Royal College of Surgeons, he might well have chosen to have his likeness rendered in oils, as many such award winners have done in the past. But for Parkinson, the medal was honour enough. Parkinson was very much a socialist politically, using his voice as Old Hubert to spread his political thinking. His political ideas extended into his daily life. He chose not to practice in the West End or further afield, but to remain in Hoxton, administering to the sick of Shoreditch and Hoxton. All of this points to a quiet, confident man, uninterested in celebrity and preferring to administer as apothecary or as surgeon to the poor of Hoxton and Shoreditch. He evidently provided a strong role model as both his son and grandson also entered the profession. Taken together, Parkinson was not a man for self-aggrandising gestures, and he would almost certainly have considered commissioning a painting to be exactly that. He didn't even name the condition after himself. It was left to Jean-Martin Charcot to call it in his honour. He has hidden his identity from us for over 200 years. Perhaps we should allow him his privacy. Perhaps we need to accept that his face will always be uncertain. Maybe it's time to let him rest in peace and accept the fact that he would not have stood up. His work did that for him. Which leaves us with a single unfinished piece of business. Who indeed is this man, this imposter, if you will, who appears in all the internet searches? Here we have to thank erstwhile colleague of mine, Simon Stott, who in 2015 identified him as James Comyne Parkinson, an Irishman who originally hoped to enter medicine but failed the classics examination. He spent his life abroad and even seeking his fortune in the Australian gold rush of 1851, before spending his last years as a lighthouse keeper in Tasmania. I should also like to end this work by giving credit where it's due. The work I've described here is the work of a host of researchers over many years, but principally it owes its existence to the outstanding scholarship of three people: Cherry Lewis, Honorary Research Fellow at the University of Bristol and author of The Enlightened Mr. Parkinson; Dr. Simon Stott, Deputy Head of Research at the Cure Parkinson's Trust and author of the excellent websites The Science of Parkinson's and Searching for James; and finally, Andrew Leeds, Emeritus Professor of Neurology at University College London and author of Mentored by a Madman. I have done no more than tell the story that they pieced together.